Well, welcome to Lifepointe Online. We're so glad to have you for worship services today. I'm Rob.
I'm Kim.
And talking to many of you, here's the phrase that I hear often. It is, man, I love Lifepointe Online. One of the things I miss, though, is being able to see everybody week to week. Yeah. I'm sure you've heard that.
I have too. And I miss it too. Like, I remember how it felt like walking in a huge group of people and seeing each other across the lobby and waving and laughing together. But you know, we know that there are hundreds of people watching Lifepointe Online every week. That means there are many of us here together right now. Mm-hmm. So if you're watching during one of the moderated service times, just jump in the chat. Say hi, maybe tell us where you're watching from. We would love to welcome you there.
I love that. Flood the chat with hundreds of little, here's my name and here's where I'm coming from. We'd love for you to do that. As we get started to worship through song, let me pray for our services. Father, we just thank you for being able, not only online, but at all of our locations, to be able to worship you, give you glory, use this time to grow us closer to your son, Jesus. We pray this. In his name, amen.
Thank you. storm surrounding me, let it break at your name. Still call the sea to still, the rage in me to still, every wave at your name. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus. Breathe and call these bones to live. Call these lungs to sing once again.
Thanks again for being here for Lifepointe Online today.
And if this is your first time with us, we have a gift for you. We would love to send you a gift, but in order to send it, we need your information. So you can get that to us on a Connect card.
Well, how do you get a Connect card, Rob?
I'm getting to that. All right, you can get the Connect card in two ways. You can get to the Connect card on our app. That's real easy to do. Or you can text hello to 919-948-7400.
While you're filling out your Connect card, we would love to know if you're in Tri-5.
Oh, I love the Tri-5.
It's amazing.
It is. Share a little bit of why Tri-5.
Tri-5 is awesome because we don't think that it's easy to find out in just one visit if Lifepointe is a church home for you. So check us out. Give us 5 weeks. Come back. Set a reminder on your phone to worship with us 5 weeks in a row. And after 5 weeks, we think you'll know.
Or another thing we do each week is we take time to celebrate generosity. And I want to tell you that your generosity is having an impact. I got to see that. I see it often, but just recently I was able to meet a young woman who reached out to the church because she had a great need. And because of your generosity, we were able to meet her needs and go beyond. And when I delivered that check, just seeing the expression on this young lady's face, like, why would somebody do this for me? She's just a great sense of gratitude. And so thank you for your generosity week in and week out. It is helping move the mission of the Lifepointe forward. And so we thank you. You can continue to give. You can make a gift today by texting LP Church to 77977. Well, next up, we're going to continue in our series as we go through the book of Mark.
Well, over the past few weeks, there have been three names getting a lot of news coverage: Reddit, GameStop, and Robinhood. And now, finally, we've all figured out what selling short means and what hedge fund managers actually do. Except this time, the little guys won and the big guys didn't. It upset the whole process, which was quite different than what the people in charge expected. Well, we're in a teaching series called Different, and we're considering how Jesus was a different kind of Messiah than anyone expected. He had a different way of teaching, and he called on his followers to think different and be different. Our lives are supposed to look different because of our commitment to the way of Jesus. So if you missed last week, you can catch up by checking out our YouTube channel. And as we go through the Gospel of Mark, we're inviting everybody to get one of these journals. You can pick one up at the link below me on the screen, but it's the entire text of the Gospel of Mark and also some places for you to make notes as you're journaling and considering what God is teaching you and showing you about how to live a different kind of life as we go through this series together. You know, generally, I'm a person that has a lot of self-confidence, but one day, that self-confidence turned to fear and doubt. And instead of looking to the future as something that was bright, it looked dark. And my belief that I could conquer anything was in serious doubt. I couldn't use my generally optimistic attitude to get better, no matter how hard I tried. No matter how much self-discipline, I couldn't get where I needed to be. I was at a tough spot, and I wasn't sure what to do next. Maybe you've been there, and you've dealt with all those things, and you're dealing with anger and pain and regret. When we do that, it can make us feel helpless. And in today's message, Mark tells us about a guy who was in a tough spot with little options for the future. That is, until he met Jesus. And we're going to start reading in Mark chapter 2. And this is at a point right after Jesus had called his first disciples, and he had started his ministry with doing a lot of healings. And so let's start reading in chapter 2, verse 1. It says, "A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them." I've been to this town in Capernaum. It sits right on the Sea of Galilee. And there's a sign when you enter the town that says, the town of Jesus. And over the years, they've uncovered some areas that go back to this very time that we're reading about. And as this town that sits right on the Sea of Galilee, it kind of served as a basis of operation for Jesus' ministry. So picture this. Jesus had healed some people. And when he did, he said, don't tell anybody about this. But they did it anyway. They posted it or whatever they did that day to spread the news. And news spread fast. And so when Jesus shows back up in his hometown, the room was full. Why do you think Jesus didn't want people to know? That's a good question. It was because he wanted to do so much more than just physically heal people. He wanted to take care of the deeper problem that we all have. But if people got sidetracked on the healing part, they might miss what's really important. And that's exactly what's happening here. So this huge crowd comes out to see this man who had healed lepers, driven out demons, and made people well. I mean, you can't blame them. If you were sick and somebody showed up in this town and they'd been healing people, you would go too. I know I would. So there's a big line outside this house. And one of the things that hasn't changed in 2,000 years is people hate to wait in line. It gets frustrating. And no one likes to wait. You know what I'm going to do today if we go to a restaurant and the line is 30 minutes or longer? I'm probably going to drive around and waste the same amount of time that I would have if I would have just waited in line because I don't like to wait. Don't judge me. Some of you do the same thing. There's some guys in this crowd, and they came for a purpose. They couldn't get close to Jesus. They didn't want to stand in line. And so some of the people in the crowd, this one group, they take matters into their own hands because they didn't want to wait. Listen what happens beginning in verse 3. Some men came, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowered the mat the man was laying on. So here's what's happening. These guys wanted to get their friends in the presence of Jesus, and so they get creative. The crowd was too big, and they're no doubt wondering, how are we going to get you noticed? And one of them probably says, hey, you know what we ought to do? And then they go on top of the house, and they start digging. So houses then probably had two rooms. The roof would have been made of mud and brick, so they get up on the roof, and they just start digging. I mean, I can imagine the conversation. Guys, the line is too long, but we have to get our friend to Jesus. He's a healer. He's healed other people. And if you're the paralyzed man, you're probably thinking, whatever it takes, just get me in front of this healer. Desperate people will do desperate things. And through all of the dirt, dust, and people yelling, hey, you jumped the line, this paralyzed man ends up in front of Jesus. And as if no one else is around, Jesus locks eyes with him and he sees them. But Jesus doesn't see desperation. He sees something different. He sees faith. Listen to what happened in verse 5. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, son, your sins are forgiven. Now, if you're just reading that, you're probably thinking, wait, I thought they were going there because he was paralyzed and he wanted to be healed. Jesus, you got the wrong guy, the wrong problem. It's his legs. He's paralyzed. He can't walk. That's what we're looking for here. But Jesus saw something different than anyone there. He saw this guy had a much bigger problem than his legs not working. He's got sin, and he's never experienced forgiveness. And I'm sure at this point, all of them are really confused. Now, at the same time, the religious leaders get mad at Jesus because they didn't like for people to feel forgiven. They didn't want Jesus on their turf teaching something different. Listen to verse 6. Now some teachers of the law were sitting there thinking to themselves, why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Immediately Jesus knew in his spirit that this was what they were thinking in their hearts, and he said to them, why are you thinking these things? Now this tells us to think carefully around Jesus because he can hear us. And that's what happened to these religious leaders. They were outraged and they accused Jesus of speaking against God himself. And Jesus then uses this moment to teach them a much deeper truth. Which is easier to say to this paralyzed man, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up, take your mat and walk? but I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. So he's giving them a choice. He's asking them, which one's easier? They came here for physical healing, but which one is the easiest to say? Well, it's easier to say, you're forgiven. And why is that? Because when Jesus said, you're forgiven, no one watching would have known if that happened or not. Only Jesus would. Think about it this way. Which is easier to see, forgiveness or healing? Well, it would be healing because you could tell immediately if Jesus was a healer or not. Imagine if Jesus was down the street from your house, in person, and you take him all of your needs, your bills, your lab tests, your hurts, your diagnosis, any physical problem you have, because you've heard that Jesus has been healing people and you want in on the action. You show up, you roll up, you limp up, and finally you're in front of Jesus and he just looks at you and says, your sins are forgiven. I would be thinking, Jesus, did you hear me? I came here with some problems I needed you to take care of, and you don't seem to be listening. And just like then, Jesus wants us to view this life through something much deeper. He wants us to view this life through the lens of eternity. And he's trying to say, I started with something you can't see, so you can experience what I want you to see. Forgiveness. Forgiveness, and that has eternal consequences. There was something even deeper, further back than what they saw on the surface. Well, a few years ago, you might remember that Toyota had a problem with accelerator sticking on certain models. And if you had one of those, you remember it. But it was a serious problem. People died because of it, and many accidents happened. And at first they thought, it's a simple fix. The floor mat is causing the accelerator to stick. But then they dug a little deeper and found out that it was actually the design of the firewall that was causing the floor mat to stick out and making the accelerator stick. So why was the firewall designed like that? Because they needed to cut costs. Well, then why did they choose to design the firewall that would make the mat stick out and cause the accelerator to stick? Because there was a manager who was told, cut costs or lose your job. Well, why was the manager told that? Because they needed to increase profits. So the final problem was the real problem. The initial problem was not the real problem they had to deal with. How many problems do people face that look like one thing on the surface, only to later discover that worry that you're dealing with, it really comes from the fear that's deep inside. The anger, it's really about control. The lack of being content, that's really about insecurity. And you can get there by just asking yourself a few questions. Why do I do that? Why do I feel that? And the answer is rarely what you see on the surface. It's almost always something deeper. Jesus goes deeper. He goes past all the outward appearances and symptoms, all of the carpeted floor mats. And he goes straight to the real problem with this guy. And he does the same thing with us. Here's something that we all need to remember today. We settle for what we want. Jesus offers us what we need. If all who were waiting on Jesus had gotten what they wanted, they would have had a political and military leader, but instead they got something different. They got a Savior that wouldn't just give us a better life now. He would give eternal life to all who follow him. I want you to stop and think for a second about something that you asked God for, that it would have wrecked your life now that you look back, or robbed you of joy, or robbed you of the better thing if you'd actually gotten it. If you're watching this live, write something in the chat that you wanted, but you're now thankful that you didn't get it. You should praise God for that. You should thank Jesus that he was good enough not to give it to you, not to answer that prayer, not to provide the opportunity, because he was looking deeper. You know, this time of year, everybody's trying to take care of their bodies a little better, and that's a good thing. We're all trying to pay closer attention to what we eat, and that's good for us. But you know what's still going to happen? These bodies, they're still going to wear out. How's that for Sunday morning encouragement? Yes, take care of it now. But a fit soul is way more important than a fit body. If Jesus tells this guy to walk, he knows that eventually something else is going to get him. Disease, old age, an accident, something. And eventually, this man who can't walk will die, whether Jesus heals him now or not. Jesus wants to do more than make us better today. He wants to make us whole forever. But in this case, there was a lesson to be taught to everybody watching, especially the religious leaders. The man had been healed from his sin, the most significant healing we can receive, and then he heard these words from Jesus. So he said to the man, "I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home." He got up, took his mat, and walked out in full view of them all. This amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." And just like that, he's healed. He can walk again. He probably ran home. He probably had a party. Now, he'll have other problems, but you know the one problem he'll never have again? Feeling the emptiness that can only be filled with Christ. He was physically healed, but he also got a healing that far surpasses the physical. His sins were forgiven. Way back when I was personally struggling with the low self-confidence I told you earlier, the worry and the fear, I kept looking further back and further back, and I discovered that some things happened to me in my childhood that I'd not fully dealt with, some very negative experiences. But once I brought them out into the open, once I brought them before Jesus, it was like an emotional switch, and God healed. How do I know God heals? Because he healed me. When all of me was in front of all of him, I was healed, and you can experience the same thing. The formerly paralyzed man with sin had an experience that changed everything. He didn't just get his legs healed, he got his soul healed, and he was made whole by Jesus. He goes home in a very different way than the way he came. He was walking. When he came in, he was carried. No one came that day expecting to see Jesus forgive sins, but that's what he did. And in this story, a theme starts to emerge, and that's the theme of people taking their friends to see Jesus. See, Jesus doesn't just ask us for worship. It's much more. He doesn't just want our commitment. It's beyond that. He expects us to participate in the mission with him. He doesn't just call us to a passive faith that sits in church or goes to Bible studies. Those are good things to do, but he has so much more for us. We get to participate with him in his mission. And you have friends who think they're solving all their problems. They think they have a fix through self-help or buying their way to happiness. And as disciples of Christ, it's our responsibility to live differently, to speak differently in such a way that gets people into the presence of Jesus. And when that happens, people change. And when people change, the world changes. So there's two questions to remember from this story. The first one is, what do I need to bring into the presence of Jesus? Because whatever it is, your hurt, your pain, your fear, your confusion, your mistakes, your problems, he sees them deeper than you ever could, and he promises to heal them. And the second question is this, who do I need to bring into the presence of Jesus? That's how this guy got in the crowd. That's how he got on the roof. That's how his friends took great risk for him and brought him into the presence of Jesus, because they were serious about bringing their friend where he needed to be. What do I need to bring in the presence of Jesus? If you're watching this live in the chat, just let us know what that is, and we'll pray for you. We'll pray with you. And who do I need to bring into the presence of Jesus? When we wrap up today, I want you to begin to think about ways that you can be the guys who carried their friend who was desperate, who was lost, who had nowhere to turn, and ensured that he got in front of Jesus so he could be healed. Not just physically, but way beyond the physical. See, as we go through the book of Mark, we're going to be challenged, not just to learn, not just to listen, but to participate with Jesus and his mission. Go and do that this week. Let's pray. God, help us to be people like these guys that carried their friend into the presence of Jesus. And Father, the problems that we deal with on the surface, may you reveal to us the core cause of what's going on in our lives. And God, I pray that as we bring ourselves, all of our mistakes and all of our problems before you, that every single person who does that feels the healing that only you can bring. And God, I pray that you give us opportunities to carry our friends into your presence so their lives can change too. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I've heard it said that sharing about my faith should be just like one hungry person telling another hungry person where they found food. That makes it sound really easy, doesn't it? When I try a new recipe or a new restaurant, it's so easy to share about it. It's so good, you have to try it. But what is this food that I have found in Jesus? If it is only life hacks or relationship help, I could be tempted to think that my friends and neighbors probably have their own way of making those things better. But that's not what following Jesus is about. Jesus changes everything. Everything. That goes way beyond making my life incrementally better. Jesus changes everything because by putting faith in him, I've been forgiven for the sin that once separated me from God. That sin that created a chasm between me and God that I couldn't do anything about. I could never be good enough. I could never earn my way back. That's the hunger of the hungry person. The Bible teaches us that we were created to be in loving union with God. Without Jesus in my life, that separation causes the hunger for that relationship. Jesus paid the price for that sin when he died on the cross. Jesus' death bought my forgiveness. And now there's nothing that can separate me from the love of God. This forgiveness is something we all need, and none of us can do anything about it on our own. Each week when we take communion, we who follow Christ have the opportunity to reflect on that forgiveness that satisfied our deepest hunger, that was made available to us because of what Jesus did on the cross. If you haven't trusted Christ for that forgiveness, why not do it today? What are you waiting for? Here I am, one hungry person telling you where you can find the food that will satisfy your hunger. If you're watching during a moderated service time, click on the I Have Decided button in the chat. We have people here who have been praying for you already today, and they will be thrilled to pray with you and walk you through it. If you're watching at another time, reach out to us on a Connect card to let us know you're deciding to follow Jesus today. So let's take the bread together. Jesus said the bread represents his body broken for us. Let's remember and be grateful. and now the drink. Jesus said it represents his blood, which was poured out for many for the forgiveness of our sins. Let's drink and remember and be grateful. Will you pray with me? Jesus, thank you for satisfying our deepest hunger. Thank you for purchasing our forgiveness on the cross and making it possible for us to have a relationship with God. Help us to live like people who know they have been forgiven much. And help us to love others the way you do. We pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks again for being part of Lifepointe Online today. We are praying for you and we hope that you have a great week. To stay up to date on all that's going on around Lifepointe, visit our website and follow us on social media. We look forward to seeing you again soon.